Ask the Lord to give us vision as we walk our daily lives and walk in fellowship with Him. Michael Green wrote that a man and his young son were working out in the backyard doing chores. Always wanting to give life examples to his son, the man asked him to break up a bundled cord of sticks that the dad had gathered over time. Dad left the boy to the task by himself. He returned a little bit later to find the lad frustrated in the task. The boy had raised the bundle high and smashed it to his knee, but only bruised his knee. He then had set the bundle against a wall and stomped hard with his foot. The bundle barely bent. The father took the bundle from the child and untied it. He then told the boy to break the sticks one at a time easily. Dad said to his son, "When things are tied together, they are harder to break. By themselves, it's easier." The Bible says in Ecclesiastes, "A cord of three strands is not quickly broken." So it is with the church. United, tied together, we are strong. Divided, or left alone, we fail or are broken. How about us? Are we tied together closely with this body of believers? Let's seek ways to bind ourselves closer together with those in this church. Amen?
Amen.
Let's open with a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for this church and what it means to us. We thank you for keeping us together, tied close, surrounded by your word. We thank you for the staff and pastor and those that work around here. And we just thank you for your love to us. We thank you for bringing us together today. We have a good day in your house. Well, thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. We're glad that you're here this morning. Grateful to have those who are guests with us. I do sense a bit of normalcy to our world in that we've greeted some folks that have visited from the north. You know, it's just been so strange since February, March of not knowing what to expect, but have some guests this morning that are down from Ohio, Michigan, Pennsylvania, and we're glad that they're here spending some time in Florida for whatever brings them here. We're glad that they're here with us today. If you are a guest, would you slip up your hand for just a moment? The gentleman would like to give you, oh, good, great. Keep your hands up. Hope they don't run out. And we've met some of you, haven't met some of you yet, but we're glad to have each and every one of you. If you'll take a moment to look through there, there's some information about our church, but the important thing is there's a blank card in there. If you'll return that card to us in the foyer, we have a gift bag for you out there. We'd love to be able to meet you personally. Thank you for being here and greet you as our guests. And if we haven't met you yet, we're glad and looking forward to doing that. Grateful to have those that are here every week. Remind you of a few things that are coming up. In the bulletin, you'll notice the ladies' activity, and then one thing that we will make announcement now, if you noticed some people took some parking spots that are some of yours, you notice that? And Lord willing, we'll begin work on the parking lot tomorrow morning. It's a long story, but the end result of it is that there is a permit and there is equipment, so we have some assurance that they'll at least be here to pick up their machines, if not to use them. But to tell you that, as we plan right now, we will be back in here on Wednesday night at 7 o'clock. It'll be a little difficult. It'll be a little limited, but we will meet Wednesday night. However, Friday, they're going to put the seal code on all of it, and so the parking lot's going to be closed until Sunday morning. So if you have business on Friday or Saturday, please note that it'll have to be changed from this property or you won't be able to park here. And be respectful if you are coming here of our neighbors. Don't just park in their lots and then leave your car. But Sunday morning, we look forward to having everything completed and finished and ready, striped for you to be here on Sunday morning. So thank the Lord with us. Rejoice with us. And then if you have opportunity to give, there were some changes we had to make to the end result of it for our handicap spots. If you'd like to give, we'd love to have you be a part of that project.
Our Sunday worship is a time of celebration when we remember the resurrection of Jesus. And it's because of his resurrection from the tomb that we have hope not only in this life, but also in the next.
How great the chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. And through the darkness your loving kindness tore through
announcement for the children. If you're ready to go, now's a good time to do that. Head toward the back, head off to Children's Church. So all the children and the workers, if you're going out for Children's Church, now's the time to go. All right, let's continue to sing about the love of Jesus. And as a result of his love, he gives us the opportunity to have compassion toward one another.
Shade of your breath.
Great singing this morning. I appreciate those who lead us in music and our choir, and those of you that participate in our corporate worship. It is a special time. It is a meaningful time. We don't do that just to fill time. If we wanted to do that, I'd just preach longer. Now, you're supposed to say amen at that, not laugh. I got to work with y'all, get you trained better. But it is something that we do to lift up the name of the Lord. It is something that the Scripture calls us to do. Paul teaches that early church at Ephesus, that it is a part of what they do to encourage one another and to speak to each other and to teach each other. And when we sing, I hope you're listening to what you're singing, because it instructs us. It reminds us of some things we already know, and it confirms those things in our hearts, and it helps us to grow in our walk with the Lord, and then it lifts Him up, and that certainly is what we're here to do. We've been talking in the last several weeks, or the last few weeks, about this theme of being stronger together. As Mike opened the service, it was a great illustration of the strength that is found in unity and harmony. But we've talked about those aspects from the book of Ephesians that remind that church to be together in what they do, to find harmony and unity, to seek peace with one another. And today I want to talk with you about the challenge of changing the world. The theme of this morning, the title this morning, is Together We Can Change the World. Let me give you an illustration today. Excuse me. September 12, 2011, Brandon Wright was a 21-year-old Utah State University student. He was driving his motorcycle to the school's computer lab when a BMW pulled out of the parking lot and collided with him. Both of the vehicles, as you see, burst into flames, and the BMW driver escaped rather quickly out of his car, but this young man named Brandon was trapped under a 4,000-pound sedan as both of the vehicles burst into flames. The horrific accident drew a lot of attention, naturally, and immediately a crowd of students and construction workers who were working nearby began to gather around the crash scene, and one passerby walked around the vehicles to survey the situation, and he saw the motionless body of the motorcycle driver, apparently dead, beneath the BMW. Another individual walked up to the car and tested his brute strength. He attempted to lift the car, but obviously wasn't able to do that, had no success. A handful of others joined the effort, but they could not budge the car. A young woman lay on the ground to peer underneath the car, and she saw evidence that the driver of the motorcycle, Brandon Wright, was still alive, and she alerted the others of that group to the fact that he was still alive. The flames intense at the front of the car, as you see it, where the motorcycle was burning as well. But at this point, a dozen members of the growing crowd joined shoulder to shoulder at the side of the car, lifting in unison, and they tilted it high enough for another rescuer to skirt underneath the car and pull him out from the wreckage to safety. At that point, the city's emergency workers responded to the scene and appeared and doused the flames and began to minister to him health and safety and transported him to the hospital, where he was treated with two broken legs and a fractured pelvis. It's a dramatic scene, but what do we draw from it? And I think the illustration, the application is very clear. What one person could not accomplish alone, a team of people did. If you were there solo and you arrived in that scene, you would be helpless. You could be compassionate, you could care, you could try, but it's likely that you wouldn't have been able to do anything. But 12 people at the side of the vehicle lifting in motion and at the same time, by the way, there has to be some unity in their lifting. If you've ever tried to move something around a church property where everybody wasn't doing it at the same time, you found it unsafe. You've been on the wrong end of this pulpit. I mean, when they did this, I think the building could have come down in Hurricane Irma and the pulpit would have still been standing here at the front. Those of you that have helped move it would agree with me. What one person cannot accomplish alone, a group of people can. Assistant Police Chief Jeff Curtis said, "Every one of those people put their lives in danger. Those people are heroes. You can only speculate what the outcome would have been if they hadn't lifted that car." And yet a group of people accomplished the securing and safety of that man involved in the accident. In one way, this is the story of the New Testament after Christ's ascension. What one person in the early church could not do, a team of believers could do. together we can change the world. Now, if you say that with enough emphasis, you get a response to it. It stirs something in you. You like to be a part of a group. Together we can change the world. What is that? Is that an inspirational speech that you pay $49 to go down to the Holiday Inn conference room and listen to someone tell you? Is it the coach at halftime telling the team if they just band together, they'll win the game? Is it a political hopeful shouting to his crowd, if we get together, we can change the world? Is it a motivational speaker at a convention of salespeople pounding the desk and shouting at them? Or could it just be the realistic expectation of the omnipotent God who calls his disciples to obedience and says to them in the early church, together you can and you should change the world? Now, it doesn't sound like that necessarily at the end of the Gospels, but as Jesus sits with his disciples in Matthew chapter 28, commissioning them to go ye into all the world, and they look at each other and say, who, us? All the world. What do you take northwest and I take southeast, and we head in different directions, and hopefully as individuals we'll do that. No, in fact, Jesus knew in his omniscience what would happen and how it could be done. Because it would not just be those handful of disciples, it would be a little larger group of disciples. And then after the day of Pentecost, it would be thousands who would band together in local assemblies and attempt to do what seems to be the impossible, reach the world with the gospel of Jesus Christ. You think of the tools and the means we have today. I broadcast this morning at 9:30. Some of our church members are up in Wisconsin. They were watching. Some of our missionary friends around the world, when we had the quarantine and we began to broadcast at that 9:30 hour. By the way, you've heard me say this, we were almost the only game in town at 9:30 doing the live Sunday school. We had a lot more watchers. At 10:30, the waters were more full of opportunities, and our viewership went down. It wasn't old just Pastor Matt at the dining room table anymore. You could have your pick of 10:30 speakers. But it's fascinating to me that we can speak and all of a sudden somebody from around the world, the Kirshners were in Taiwan and it was nighttime for them, but they would comment, we're watching Sunday school or we're watching church. And the Thompsons, who were in England 5 or 6 hours ahead of us, they would comment that they were watching, and people from different parts of the country and different parts of the world. How easy it is now to disseminate the gospel to the world. I did it from my own dining room for 4 months or three, however long it was. 3 years. I don't know how long it is anymore. Is it? Are we still doing this? We were walking through the airport. And we flew to Ohio for the BCMN meeting, and my wife and I were there coming back, and I said, they were making an announcement on the speaker, and I said, I grew up watching science fiction films that looked like this. That was just me. But we have the technology now and the ability to get on a plane and go halfway around the world and to send missionaries that can go and come back in a day, and we can do it by means of broadcast. And Jesus says to his disciples, you're going to accomplish this, and they don't have those tools. Seems rather impossible to me. But it is the realistic expectation of an omnipotent God who commissions his disciples. Be obedient. Be of service and outreach and ministry and evangelistically minded, and you will reach the world with the gospel. Acts chapter 1:8, he says to them, but ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth. And again, we probably put ourselves in their shoes and say, well, what a wonderful analogy, the uttermost part of the earth. I get the Jerusalem part. I can handle that. And if we put our mind to it, we can reach Judea. If we get our heart into it, we could reach Samaria. But man, the uttermost part of the earth? How do we do that? Notice that he was speaking to them as an assembly at that time. As bold as any one of the disciples might have been, they could never have impacted Jerusalem, much less beyond that, by themselves. But as the Lord Jesus points out in Acts chapter 1:8, it would never be just them alone, because they would be empowered by the Holy Spirit. So even when Peter stands seemingly alone, though with the encouragement of the other apostles, Peter stands alone at Jerusalem and preaches to the masses. He is not indeed alone because he has the Holy Spirit residing within him to speak to that crowd. And thousands are changed that day. I want to open our eyes today to the fact that it is not just little old me, but if you're a believer, it is you and the Holy Spirit of God living within you. And it is never intended to be just little old me as a Christian, because God has put us into a body, a family, to do things bigger than we can do on our own. No, it's not missions conference time, but there is to be a thought in our head of what are we doing to reach the world beyond the places that we can go. We send people to do that. But lest we wash our hands after having sent out missionaries and say, well, we've done our part, remember that that commission of Acts chapter 1, verse 8 begins in the city of Jerusalem where they lived. That's our calling. He's speaking to them as an assembly and saying to them, it is in fact possible if you are together to change the world for the gospel of Jesus Christ. Would you join me in prayer that God would open our eyes as to our part in reaching the world and changing the world that we lament about and we wring our hands about and say there's nothing that can be done, when in fact God has said there is something that can be done, and it always works if we'll do it. Father, help us today to understand from your word what it is you have for us. Help us to see beyond even the things we've heard before to understand what you have for us today. And Lord, you've given us a commission. It is indeed weighty. It is global. It is significant. And we sometimes shrink in the face of it, but help us to put our shoulders back and realize that it is within the scope of our calling, and it is within the scope of our ability, because we do not stand alone, nor do we stand in our own strength. Help us today then to put into practice what you have called us to do oh so many years ago. Help us to realize our place in the world and our place in this church and in the body of Christ to do what it is you've called us to do. And Father, I pray that someone listening right now or watching this later will recognize they do not have a place in that body yet because they haven't trusted Christ as Savior. Convict them today. Draw them today. Give them courage and boldness to step out and to call on the name of Jesus Christ, who has given his life and shed his blood on their behalf. May they see in him the answer for their sin problem and trust him today. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. I'd invite your attention this morning to the book of Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 25. We've been in the book of Ephesians for a few weeks. Now you're going to read this, or you're going to listen to me read it, or you're going to read along as I read it, and you're going to say, I don't get it. Now that is if you're paying attention. If you're just reading it and let somebody else talk and you're not paying attention, you won't catch it. But if you read through these verses and you listen to this introduction and say, how does Ephesians 4:25 and following have anything to do with reaching the world, then you have to stay awake for a few more minutes to find out how. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 25. Read there with me. Paul, writing to that church, says, wherefore, putting away lying, speak every man truth with his neighbor, for we are members one of another. Be ye angry and sin not. Let not the sun go down upon your wrath. Neither give place to the devil. Let him that stole steal no more, but rather let him labor, working with his hands the thing which is good, that he may have to give to them that needeth. Let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, but that which is good to the use of edifying, that it may minister grace unto the hearers. And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby ye are sealed unto the day of redemption. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice, and be ye kind one to another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. We come to these verses that are instruction for interacting with each other. Simple, practical, direct, good for relationships. But there is something larger in this context. If you read this, you can break it down into just tips for getting along. And I probably preach something similar to that. How to live well at home and how to live well in the church. And if you have a problem and you find out that nobody gets along with you, then put these things into practice and you'll be better off. It is a wonderful text for that. But there is something larger, and I'd like to show it to you this morning. In fact, we have to jump back several verses to the chapter 4, verse 1, and look at our first point, this. We have a great calling. You as a believer in Christ have a great calling. Look at verse number 1 of this chapter. I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that you walk worthy of the vocation wherewith ye are called. The whole premise of chapter 4, and in fact much of the book of Ephesians, is this calling that we have as Christians. The word there used in the verse, he says, for you walk, that you walk worthy of the vocation. Now for us, we talk about that being the occupation that we hold, our vocation. But in reality, that word, klesis, means a calling. It's a relationship and a task that goes with it. It is our station in life. It is what we are meant to do. And he says, as believers, you all have one calling. You have a unified calling. Now, your job, your vocation in this life might be a plumber, electrician, a school teacher, a housewife, a bus driver, whatever you fit. But for the believer, it is a unified calling. And he says to walk worthy of it. The word worthy there meaning becoming or fitting. Something that fits it. It looks like it. So you have a calling, and then he says, live like that calling. Act like that calling. Make sure when someone sees you that they recognize that you fit that calling. I mentioned we were in the airport and we sat down to wait distance from everyone else until you get on the plane, and then it's a sardine can. But the young man that was sitting over here, and we came from Canton, if you know anything, that's the home of the National Football League's Hall of Fame. And the young man that sat here had a shirt, and it said NFL alumni. And it had some other things on him. Now, I looked at the shirt, and I said to my wife, he used to play in the NFL. And she said, how do you know? I said, he had a shirt. Then it dawned on me. I probably could have bought that shirt in the gift shop. And then I looked again, and I said, he played in the NFL. Because he looked like he did. And you know what the Bible says in chapter 4, verse 1? You ought to walk and live and act and talk like your calling, which is to be a follower of Jesus Christ, a believer in him. It ought to fit. People ought to be able to look at you and say, yeah, they say they're a Christian, and I see that. Walk worthy of it. The calling is nothing less than representing Jesus Christ to a world that doesn't know him. By the way, it's as simple as that. What's my calling? Represent Jesus in the world. Reflect on him in what we say and do. The unsaved world does not acknowledge him. The unsaved world does not even recognize him these days. And this is a great task, to represent him to others. Look on with me at verses 2 and 3. He says, with all lowliness and meekness, with long suffering, forbearing one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Yes, there is a calling to get along together, but what for? And again, if you look at chapter 4, it's very clear that he's talking about interpersonal relationships, getting along with people. But I would propose to you there's another thing behind this. What is he calling? Why is he calling for them to get along? What for? Is it just so that they can hang out together without fighting? Is it just so that they can spend time with each other and enjoy each other's company? No way. As important as community is, as important as simple fellowship is, we will have all eternity to do that. Now, people, you've heard it probably preached before, well, this is just practice for us getting along in heaven. All right, I'll take that if that's the way you want to preach it. But I think there's something bigger at stake. Because the reality is that if God's children do not work in unity, then he goes unrepresented in the world. And if God's children are fighting and spatting and going off in different directions and having their own personal agendas, then he does not get represented to people who need to know him before this life is over. If it was just for us to get along, then let's just do that in eternity. Let's just wait for heaven, and we'll fellowship and we'll have a unified purpose, and God will make us all fit for that. But what is Paul saying? You're going to have to begin to do this now. Because you are the picture of Jesus Christ to the world. Now, by the way, if you're not sure of that, I don't have time for it this morning. But you read on in chapter 5, and he's going to tell husbands and wives, you're a picture. And he's going to tell children and parents, you're a picture. And servants and masters, you're a picture of Jesus Christ and how he loves us and how he cares for us. I believe that's throughout this book. What is he saying here? This is your calling. What did Jesus himself say? By this shall all men know that ye are my disciples, if ye have love one to another. Jesus could have given them homiletics classes on how to preach. He could have spent his time instructing them about how to parse sentences and diagram, oh my heavens, diagramming sentences. I'd have rather drawn up engineering plans for a building than diagram sentences. You know what Jesus told them here? The one thing that's going to mark you is not your persuasiveness of speech. It's not your flamboyance. It's not your charisma. It is your love for one another. The simple fact that you show something different to the world than what they're used to. That's your calling. We have a great calling, church. More than just directions, it is what God has commissioned us to do. Number two, this morning we have a great challenge. Now, wouldn't it be just, I hesitate to ask this, wouldn't it be nice if it were just that easy and you only needed the first point of the sermon? Then you could all leave. But wouldn't it be nice in life if it were just that easy, just that simple? Be a Christian and let the world see it. Get along with everybody, and we'll march on our merry way. But there is a great challenge. Remember the song, "This Little Light of Mine, I'm Gonna Let It Shine. This Little Light of Mine, I'm Gonna Let It Shine, Let It Shine, Let It Shine. Don't let Satan it out. Hide it under a bushel." Now, that was weaker than Sunday school there. How many found it easier to sing that song when you were in children's Sunday school than to live it out as a believer? "This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine." We sang it when we were little, but the calling we have is much more challenging, isn't it? "I'm gonna let my light shine to the world," but the world doesn't like that light. Well, then I just won't show it. "People are mean, I don't like to show it. It's not convenient. I've got other things to do. I'll show it later." It was much easier to sing about it when we were little than to do it. The challenge, as we've studied earlier, is to get along. The inward opportunity. I would rather call it that than the challenge, but we'll leave it for that this morning. It's an opportunity that we have. Why? Because when we do love one another, when we do live in harmony and unity and seek peace with one another, the opportunity is that we, in that simple fact, will show what a Christian looks like to the world. Shouldn't this be, watch this statement, shouldn't this be the natural behavior, Pastor? Shouldn't it just come naturally because we're all family? Amen, right? How many of you had a brother or sister at home when you grew up? How'd that work out? That is the most natural relationship to demonstrate care, concern, love, looking out for each other. And you had your moments, surely you had your moments where you defended and you took up for them and you took the heat for them. You all nod your head, but you had your moments just like every other siblings when it wasn't the most natural thing to get along. That proximity, we would call this prolonged proximity. How many of you discovered that has a way of testing your, I see the Doan young ones looking at each other, and I didn't think of that when I said it. There was a knowing look on their face. Prolonged proximity. You can love somebody, but if you stick them in the car for a long enough road trip, you'll be at each other's throats. It is not always the most natural, easy thing to do. Why? Because we're selfish at heart. We're rebellious at heart. Sometimes you would fight for your brother or sister, and then there were other moments where you would fight with them. Look at the verses in verse 25 and following that we read this morning. What does Paul tell that church at Ephesus that they need to do? Remember, the calling is in verse 1, walk worthy of your vocation, walk worthy of your calling. And then he says what they're supposed to be doing, and then this is still in the same context. Although many verses later, he says in verse 25, put away lying and speak truth. So stop lying, tell the truth. Don't sin in your anger. When you get angry, don't let it lead to sin. Don't steal from other people, but work. Don't let any corrupt communication come out of your mouth. All the things that you say should build up people. And then verse 31, let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor, evil speaking, be put away from you with all malice. And verse 32, be kind one to another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another. We have a great challenge here. These instructions are all addressed to and concerning members with each other. The challenge is to put them in place. It's part of your calling. It's part of what you are designed to do as a Christian, added to a local assembly, the body of Christ, added to this family of God. The challenge is to get along. So we have to recognize it doesn't just come naturally. If you sit back and wait for it to happen, someone will step on your toes, you'll be offended, and you'll walk away. And it's happened to others before you. In the final phrase, we are introduced again to the bigger picture, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. More than just being kind, more than just getting along, we are to represent Christ. Why forgive other people? Well, it helps to get along. You're right. But it also reflects what Jesus has done for us. Hey, why did you forgive that person? Because Jesus forgave me. We have a great opponent. Point number three. We have a great challenge, and we have a, or we would call it an opportunity, but we also have a great opponent, an enemy. Heads up. Take notes. It's not your brothers and sisters. It's not. And too often we miss it at this point, and we get no further. Oh, wait a minute, Pastor Matt. Are you sure it's not one of my brothers or sisters? They really get under my skin. I was waiting for amens there. I'm just going to take notes. Pastor Matt, are you sure it's not a brother or sister? They seem to oppose everything I stand for, everything I try to do. If I try to do something good, they're there in the way to trip me up. You can list all your woes and foibles, and I've heard them before. I've lived them before, probably on both sides of the fence. Ultimately, they may prove to be a challenge, but I assure you this morning that that believing brother and sister is not your enemy, not your opponent. The enemy is identified in verse 27. What does he say? Neither give place to the devil. I want you to realize the importance of living in unity and harmony. Now, first of all, I hope you got it this morning, that when we fail to do that, we fail our mission. We fail our calling in life. When we don't get along, the job of reaching the world does not get done. Can you imagine? And by the way, this is just outside here. I'll just say it for a minute. Can you imagine those first handful of disciples? Do you think they really thought everything alike? There's no way. I'm planning what we're going to look at next in the next month or so, leading into an election and all this, and still working on some things. And I was stricken, and I probably will bring it up, of the diversity among those disciples. They did not naturally think alike. They didn't come from the same backgrounds. They didn't have harmony in their heart. And if at that point Jesus says to them, "Ye shall receive power and go and be witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea," if the natural would have taken over, they would have said, "Okay, you go to Jerusalem because I don't want to be anywhere near you. I'm going all the way out. I'd rather go to Samaria than work with you." That's what we would have heard from the disciples. "Put me in the uttermost part so I don't have to deal with people," if left to their own devices. It didn't come naturally, and they could have easily identified their brothers in Christ as their opponent or their enemy. Are you sure about that? Remember James and John going, "Lord, who gets to sit on your right hand and your left?" They made some lists that day. Somebody put them down to watch. Keep an eye on them. They're always trying to climb over me to get ahead. The opponent, however, is very clearly identified in verse 27, and he says, "It is the devil. Don't give place to him." The passage makes it clear that our interaction with one another can either open the door to or close the door to Satan's work in our life and in our church, or it can slam it shut. Our interacting with other people, both within the family of God and outside the family of God, will push the door open to an entrance for Satan to get a foothold, to do his work, to sow discord, to sow apathy, you name it. Or it can shut the door. I have in my notes the Randy Stonehill song. I will not sing it. I debated it. Shut the door. Keep out the devil. Shut the door, keep the devil in the night. I worked at a radio station when I was in college. I loved playing that one because it was different. Takes you to the islands there. But what is that old song that he did? What does it sing? What we do will shut Satan out, or it will, what does Paul say? Or you're going to open the door. Listen, you fight with your brother. Go ahead. Go right ahead. But do not be surprised when Satan is right there behind him, ready to sow discord in your life, ready to sow corruption in your life, ready to disrupt any thought you ever had about evangelism or representing Christ to the world. He's there waiting. The problem comes when we make an enemy out of a brother. Look at the list of instructions. They direct us to unity in conduct and purpose. Get along. Don't lie. Tell the truth. Don't steal. Work hard. No anger or malice or bitterness, wrath. Do what is needed to be at peace internally because you have an enemy waiting to seize your weakness. For the past several years, I've had the opportunity to work with basketball teams as Aaron played, helped coach those teams. And one of the things I always found helpful for me, because I didn't have a lot of advice to offer, even when the coaches would ask, but I would sit there on the bench at halftime, and the team would often leave behind our bench or near it, and they had no concerns about airing their conversations publicly as they walked out. And so while the other coaches might have been doing something, I was gathering up things, and they would walk out, and you could hear the fighting. You could hear the infighting. You could hear the bitterness. You could hear them talking about another person. You could hear them complaining to the coach. And, man, I just took notes all day, and I went into the locker room. Coach was done, and I'd say, listen, 4 is at it with 10, and they hate that they're covering him, and they don't want to do this, and they didn't like their last assignment, and somebody over there doesn't know that. And I would just let them know. Why? Because I didn't go eavesdrop. They just did it in public. But one of the quickest things you'll do to disrupt another team is to find out that they have infighting among that team. They're not going to work together. Satan knows that too. Identify the correct opponent and don't give him an inch. Final point this morning. Look at verses 1 and 2 of the next chapter. Covered a lot of ground today to make our point. Chapter 5, verses 1 and 2. Be ye therefore followers of God as dear children. If you have a highlighter, highlight it. If you have an underlining pen, underline it. If you have your Bible YouVersion, highlight that. Be ye therefore followers of God. Pastor, what's my vocation? What's my calling that you talked about in chapter 4, verse 1? Underline it. Be a follower of God. And walk in love as Christ also hath loved us and hath given himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling savor. Be an imitator, that word says. Not just to follow after, but to follow after in step and in unison and directing others to see him, that I am imitating him in my behavior. Who can change the world? Now, before you answer that with the thought of this morning, well, the church, Pastor, you've told us already. The believers, when they get together unified, can change the world. Not really the full correct answer. The correct answer is, who can change the world? Jesus Christ alone. On our best day, with our most unified effort, you and I and the body assembled here today cannot change the world. Only Jesus can do that. My best behavior, I cannot change a person's heart, much less the world, but I can introduce them to the one who can change them. That's our calling. Be an imitator of Jesus so that when they see you, they see him. They recognize him. They want to know him. He's made attractive and glorified in their eyes by what you and I do. Christians, we get the grand opportunity to imitate him so that he can change the world. What did they see in Peter? They saw a fisherman. They saw a guy with a hot head, with a temper. They saw a guy who was a bit rebellious at times, who was weak and a betrayer, disloyal, you name it. But on the day of Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit had come upon them and he begins to preach, what happens? Thousands upon thousands trust. Why? I would propose to you, you need to go back and read the message that he preaches in the book of Acts at the beginning of it, because it is all about Jesus. You don't get from one verse to the next without knowing about Jesus. Peter's not there to tell you his story. He's not there to give you his testimony. He's not there to persuade you with what he knows or what he thinks. He just wants you to see Jesus. If we're ever going to do anything for our families or our city or our nation or the world, it has to simply be that. They have to see and know Jesus Christ. That's it. Be imitators of Christ. That's our calling. Is that enough, Pastor Matt? What about the Great Commission? What about go ye into all the world? Remember, we started with this verse in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, about Judea and Samaria, Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, the uttermost part of the earth. Do you remember what the commission actually was in chapter 1, verse 8 of Acts? Ye shall be witnesses unto me. You're going to be imitators. You're going to be followers. You're going to simply direct people. You're going to point them there. Verse 32, again, it says, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. Paul, why devote all this attention to how to get along with brothers and sisters? Why all this space in your book to interpersonal action in relationships? Why in almost every early church is there an epistle written with direction and correction about their relationships and about the behavior with each other? Virtually every epistle has something in there about how to act with each other or fixing something they were doing incorrectly. Because there were believers there just like us, and there was a task assigned to believers that could only be accomplished when there was harmony and unity of purpose within the body of Christ. The question today is, will we respond to our calling? Will we rise to the challenge that God has put before us? Will we properly identify who our enemy is? And will we simply follow Christ and be his imitator? It's as simple as that. Sometimes we come and we listen to a message and we say, well, that was good. I get stirred up for a minute. I like the treatment of that text. I always appreciate hearing this or appreciate that. It really doesn't matter unless we're willing to take this and do something with it, to do what God's called us to do. Do you understand today that your calling is nothing less than being a reflection of the Most High God and his Son who loved us and died for us? Here's the question for some of you today. Do you belong first to this family of God? It's impossible to imitate him in reality unless you have been added to his family. Can you truly call Christians your brothers and sisters? Have you been forgiven first? If not, it's impossible for you to enact any change in the world. Impossible to see lives transformed because your life needs it first. And I don't say that with condemnation. I say that with wonderful opportunity because all of us stand in the same position. We all need Jesus Christ as our Savior because we're all sinful. But if you've yet to respond to him by faith, can I encourage you today? Trust Jesus Christ. Stop trying to do it on your own. Stop trying to be good enough or turn over a new leaf. Simply trust the fact that God loved you, sent his Son to die for you, he shed his blood for you, and his payment covers your sins. It really is that simple. Trust him today. God, I believe I'm sinful. I can't do anything about it. And Jesus paid for my sins. I'm so glad. I want to be forgiven. He'll save you. That's his promise. Christians, we have a calling. The task is immense, and we will only meet it when we operate as Christ has called us to do. Will you be willing to pick up that challenge today and do it? Would you stand, please? With your heads bowed and your eyes closed this morning, God has spoken to our hearts. I'd encourage you this morning, if you don't know Jesus Christ, right where you stand, would you call out and be saved? Would you ask him to save you because of the work and the merit of Jesus Christ and not of your own? If you have questions about that, let me give you this invitation. You step out right where you are right now. No one's looking around. We'd love to talk with you. Someone will take you and show you in God's Word what it says. They'll help you with it. They'll answer your questions and take as much time as is needed. Would you do that this morning while we come to the close of this service? Pastor, I need to be saved. I want to be changed. I want to be forgiven. If that's your desire this morning, you come and allow someone to show you how you can be saved today. Christian, would you come to this altar and say, God, I need to mend a relationship. God, I need to make something right between me and a brother or sister, maybe within my own family, maybe someone who has been long an opponent of mine, or I seem to think that. Lord, help me to see them differently today. We've been given a great blessing in this gospel, and we have a great challenge to do something with it. Will you commit to being a witness? God, I've been quiet about it. I've been just hoping people would understand the gospel. I need to tell them. I need to be an imitator of Christ. Maybe someone this morning, you're recognizing as the Holy Spirit speaks to your heart, this is an area of my life that does not reflect Jesus. And not only is it dampening my witness, but it's also opening a door for an opponent to come in. God, help us to find those things in our life that are areas of concern, but even deeper than that, they're a problem for our walk and for our testimony. Would you confess it to God today, right now where you stand or at this altar? God, I know that this is wrong. I know that I have a problem here, and it needs to be corrected. I need you to do that so that I can be the best witness I can for you. God, help us today to realize the need in our own life so that we can be a part of doing something bigger than we could ever do on our own. Bless us today, Lord. Help us to respond. In your Son's name we pray. Amen. Help us this morning by responding as God speaks to your heart. Help us by singing today this reminder of what God has done for us. Freely, freely you have received. Freely, freely give. God, help us today to do what he's called us to do. Sing with us. Freely, freely you have received. Freely, freely give. God forgave my sin in Jesus' name. I've been born again in Jesus' name. And in Jesus' name I come to you to share his love as he told. This is the reality of what Jesus said. He said freely, freely. Go in my name, and because you believe, others will know that I live. We can look at the challenge and say it's too big. We can shrug our shoulders and say it's for somebody else to do, somebody bigger or more equipped or better at it than we are. But that's not the reality of Scripture. Well, we can say, well, we're not like the church at Ephesus. We're just little old us. I think it would always be interesting to know what kind of people they had in any of those first century churches. And we would look and say, it was them? They're just normal. They're just average. In fact, they've got some weaknesses. They've got some problems. And we would be right. And what happened? That whole region of the world understood about Jesus Christ. Lives were changed. Other churches were started. People were reached, and the world, as they knew it, was changed. In fact, at Ephesus, they were known for disrupting things that were corrupt. Would to God that that would be our testimony, not just as individuals, but as a body, that God would use us to do something bigger than ourselves. It's a great challenge, but we have a great God. Would you agree with me today? Let me encourage you to be back tonight. We're going to continue our study in the book of Hosea for a few minutes. And then a reminder, we will plan to be back on Wednesday night, 7 o'clock, but you stay in tune. We'll just put it that way. We have no real idea what will happen. We have a rough estimate of what day things are going to happen. We will say with great assurance that on Friday they are planning to have the seal coat done. That will need to remain untouched all the way through till Sunday morning. But the good news is we'll be back here and you can drive on it and your spot will still be there. It'll just be shiny and new looking. We will tell you, if you use the handicapped spots, there will be some changes with that because of the Americans with Disabilities Act and the things that have to happen. So the parking spots will be up here towards the front. There will be four of them and a pass through, we believe, from the south side of our property to the north. You'll see that better next Sunday morning. And if you do run into a difficulty or problem, you let us know. If someone parked in your spot, join me and Bob Dixon out in the back on the grass. And walk. It's a good, healthy Sunday morning activity, unless it's raining. Father, thank you today that you love us, that you give us a calling. You haven't just left us to live life on our own. You've put us here in relationship with other people, and you've given us a task. Lord, we pray for our city. We pray for our community and the people around us that need to know Jesus. May we be sensitive to that. May we be never calloused to the spiritual need of others. And I pray that you'd help us to effect change, not because of who we are or what we do, but simply because we know you and we want to reflect you well. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. Hey, happy birthday, man. I think I told you that already. Sorry. Yeah. And then he did his magic.
It's not my life to live. It's not my song to sing.
Well, it could have been worse.
All I have is here.
Hi, good morning.
For all eternity.
Good to see you guys. Yes, sir.
It's not my righteousness. It's not my faithfulness, and all I have is His for all eternity. And we will crown Him, King of glory, crown Him, Lord of all, crown Him, King of glory, crown Him, Lord of all. It's not my war to win. It's not my way to bear. That stands in my defense, and though we're